All right, thank you for that. Just before you're seated, I want everybody just to stay standing just for a second, because I want you to know why you're standing. I know we have a lot of new people in this place, and you might not know why you stand before the pastor or the preacher gets up front, but I want to tell you why. There's a couple of different reasons. One, it's your body telling your spirit and your soul to get ready, because you're about ready to receive something that you need. But also, it's a little bit more than that. You know, if I were to tell you that there were a lot of buried treasure in the field right next to us, and I could show you where it's at, how many of you all would rush out, get shovels, pickaxes, you know, get some dynamite, whatever you got to do to get in that ground to get the treasure? I mean, if you didn't have access to that, you'd go up there and you'd find a stick, you'd use your hands, and you would try to just dig in there to get to that treasure. Can I tell you right now that we have something to offer that is a far greater value than just some treasure, just some money? We have the words of life. We have the words of Jesus to instill hope and value into our life. And so I hope that you came ready this morning to receive. Did you come ready to receive? Matter of fact, why don't we just do this? As you find your seat, why don't you find three people and just tell them, hey, I'm ready. Are you? Hey, I'm ready. Are you? Well, I just want to start off by saying that I am really so excited to be able to journey with you as we just walk through the book of Philippians. As Pastor Corey said, this is going to be an exegetical study, and that's just a very churchy word that just means we're going to look at it verse by verse, section by section, or in our case, chapter by chapter. This book is four chapters long, so we're just going to cover a chapter a week over the next 4 weeks. Now, let me just lay a little bit of foundation, a little bit of groundwork before we get started. We need to look at context, because before we read this, we really have to understand what's going on whenever the Apostle Paul wrote this letter to the church in Philippi. You see, the Apostle Paul founded and started this church in Philippi in 52 AD. He went there, he led people to Christ, and he established the church in that town. Then, this is 10 years later, after the church had already been founded, that he goes to write this letter. And he writes this letter for a couple of different reasons, but one of the main reasons why he writes this letter to the Philippians is that they had actually taken up an offering and they sent it to Paul. It was a very generous gift. Now, if you know anything about Paul, in other letters, he actually tells the churches, hey, I don't want any money. As a matter of fact, when I come, I'm going to work so I'm not a burden to you, right? I don't want to really, you know, affect that relationship that we have. But the Philippians, they ended up sending Paul this incredible gift. And so he's actually going to take the time to write them a thank you letter. That's what this letter really is. The book of Philippians, it's a thank you letter to tell them how appreciative he is of them sending this gift. Now, we're going to see one theme too rise to the top. Matter of fact, it's a theme that runs throughout this book, and it's the theme of having joy. Matter of fact, the word joy or rejoice is in this book 19 times. It's only four chapters, but it's in there 19 times. And the important thing about this is this, and this is going to help shape your perspective as we read through this book. We need one little other piece of information. You see, sometimes when we just get one piece of information, it changes our whole perspective, right? It's kind of like this. How many of you have ever met someone and right away you just did not like them? It's okay. You can raise your hand. Right? They rubbed you the wrong way, they were rude, they were arrogant. But how many of you, this person that you met for the first time and right away didn't like them, maybe later you found out that they were going through a rough time, maybe they had just lost their job, maybe their kids were going all crazy and just really causing a lot of stress. How many of you all, with that one little bit of information, that one little piece of information, your perspective changed? Right? Or how about this? How many of you have ever had a bad day? I'm talking like a bad day, all of us, right? We've all have those days, right? We have those bad days, but how many of us, whenever we maybe go sit down with someone over lunch, maybe it's a friend, Maybe it's a coworker and they're sharing how they just lost someone in their family, or sharing how they just, you know, had someone in their family get diagnosed with cancer. How many of y'all know your day is not so bad anymore? Right? That one little bit of information changes your whole perspective. Well, I got to give you one little bit of information that is going to change your entire perspective on how you read through this book. And it's this. This entire letter, Paul wrote this to the Philippian church while he himself was in prison. He wrote one of the most joy-filled books in the entire Bible while he himself was in prison. I'm talking about chained to a Roman guard 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And if we read in Acts 28, we know that he is actually in this prison under house arrest for 2 years. For 2 years, he's chained up. And yet, he writes this joy-filled letter. So here's what we're going to do. We're just going to kind of break it down. I'm going to read a lot of the chapter to you today. And this is just what an exegetical study is. It really allows just the Word of God to speak into our life. And so if you brought your Bibles, I encourage you to get them out. Open up with me to verse 3 of chapter 1. And we're going to begin our journey there. This is what Paul writes. He said, "I thank God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for you, for all of you, I always pray with what? Joy. Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now." And then he says, "being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you," and he was there in the beginning, right? He planted the church. He led most of these people to Christ. He says that he who began a good work in you will continue to carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And then verse 7, "It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. And whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me." You see, I want to point out first off this contrast. Paul says, whether I'm in chains, right, I'm in prison, or if I'm free to just go out and defend and preach the gospel in the streets. Either way, all of you share God's grace with me in this journey. You see, I have to believe that Paul probably wished he wasn't in prison. Right? Nobody wants to go to jail, especially Paul, who was just preaching Christ and they put him in jail for doing so. I'm sure he wished things were different. I'm sure he wished he was just free to go and just minister and share out in the streets of Rome and not in prison. I'm sure he wished it was different. I'm going to just stop and ask you all a question here this morning. And it's a question that I ask pretty frequently, but I think it's a great question to really start us in the thinking process of our life. And I'm just curious, how many of you have something in your life that you wish were different? You wish something was different. You know, if you're young, maybe you're like, "man, I wish I was older." Those of us who are older, we're like, "man, we wish we were a little younger." Maybe it's we wish we were in a different job. We wish maybe we had different friends or maybe friends at all. You know, maybe for those of you who aren't married, you wish you were married. Those of you who are married, maybe you're like, "man, I wish we had a better marriage." And if that's you, I encourage you to go on our website and listen or watch the last three messages in our series. You know, if you have kids, you might be like, "man, I just wished I had kids that behaved better." Let's just say that. I'm not going to say what I was going to say. Or if you don't have kids, maybe you're like, "man, I really wish I had kids." You just wish something we're different. I'm sure we've all been in this place. "Man, I just wish something were different." And if that's you here this morning, I really want you to hone in on this very next verse. Because listen to Paul. I'm sure he wished he wasn't in prison, that he wasn't chained to a guard. But he said this, verse 12. "Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me," he's talking about him being put in prison, him being chained all day long, 24 hours a day, to a Roman soldier. "What has happened to me?" Think about what has happened to you. I'm not necessarily talking about things you've even done. I'm talking about maybe some things that were outside of your control that you wish were different. He goes, "this thing that has happened to me," man, check out this perspective. He said, "it has actually served to advance the gospel. Me being in prison has actually helped serve to advance the gospel." And this word advance, it's a military term that means to go in front of and to begin to remove obstacles so the army can make its way through. And he said, look, all of you all think that I'm in jail and this is a terrible thing and it's a bad thing, but I'm telling you right now, this thing that has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel, to establish the kingdom even more. Man, we got to realize the God that we serve, that he can take what the enemy meant for good and he can for evil, and he can bring about a good in that thing which you are maybe in despair of. It's like this. We serve a God so big, and I love that, that we can look at obstacles in our life and we can see them as things that like hinder us greatly, or we can realize that God wants to do something through them and we can then begin to see them as an opportunity instead of an obstacle. You know, we can see things that might be a setback, but with God, we know that it could just be maybe a step up into something else that he has for us, right? We can see this thing that maybe we're chained to, that we're tied to, and we might feel like we're in prison, but I'm telling you right now, church, that prison can become your pulpit if you can begin to change your perspective on the thing. Two stories to go along with that, and these are just kind of some things that God has been kind of showing me just this week. The first one, I'm a little ashamed to say this and to share this because I know I'm going to get a lot of flack from Corey on Monday morning. But on Thursday night, Mel and I were driving home, and we decide to stop at McDonald's for some ice cream. Just ice cream. We weren't going to eat there. So we get these, we go and we order these McFlurries, right? They're amazing, but whatever. So I order this ice cream, and then the guy on the other end taking my order is like, hey, can I interest you in 3 cookies for $1? And I'm like, oh, man. And then he goes on to say, I'm telling you right now, they just got out of the oven. They're piping hot. They're delicious. I promise you, you will not regret these 3 cookies. And I'm like, who is this guy on the other end of this thing? So I'm like, man, no thanks. See, I was good. I didn't order cookies too, Corey, see? So I get up to the drive-thru window, and I actually just have to share, you know, just with this guy a little bit about how much I really appreciated his salesmanship. And so I said, man, dude, what are you doing at McDonald's? Like, you are an incredible salesman. Do you realize how you almost had me talked into those cookies? And he just kind of smiled, and he goes, man, I'm going to tell you what, I've actually sold 600 cookies already this shift. And I'm like, you got to be kidding me. Like, are you serious? He goes, man, everybody thinks that like this is some dead end loser job and like I'm gonna be a nobody. But I come in here every single day and I kind of take it upon myself to challenge myself to pick one item, and I'm gonna sell the heck out of that item, and it only goes to help McDonald's, which then if it's helping McDonald's and I work for McDonald's, it's only gonna help me as well. And I got to thinking about that this week, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, if we could all just have that perspective when it comes to the kingdom of God, that no matter our situation or our circumstance or where we find ourselves in, if we could have a change of perspective and see how much of a difference we can truly make with what God's given us, how much more can we succeed in reaching this community for Christ? Man, what you learn at the drive-thru McDonald's, right? Man. Another story is, so I did that on Thursday, and Friday morning I pull into this place, and I'm just thinking about the facility that we have here, and we have an amazing facility, church. We really do. We have an amazing facility, and as Corey said, it's debt-free, and I pull in here, and man, I'm just blown away sometime when I come into this place to realize what we have. I never want to take it for granted. I really want to be grateful for what we have, but at the same time, sometimes my thoughts kind of go towards, man, I wish this was in a different location, right? Because what they say, you know, if you're going to really get into a place where your church is really influencing a lot of people, you really got to look at where you're planting, where the church is, right? It's all about location, location, location. And I was just praying through that and like, God, this is an amazing place, man. Wouldn't it be awesome if it were somewhere else or closer to or more accessible to people? And God just stopped me right there. He just stopped me right there, and I remember the night before going through that drive-thru, and I'm thinking, okay, God, how do you want to change my perspective in this? And he just said, instead of looking at it where you're not, why don't you just look at where exactly you are, that you're in a strategic place for a divine purpose to really reach this community for Christ, because there are people in this community more so that don't know me than do know me, so you got still work to do. We got work to do, church, but it all comes down to perspective. Man, Paul says, man, what's happened to me is actually served to advance the gospel. Man, verse 13, halfway through the chapter, and we're really going to see this story come to life. Check this out. He says this. As a result of me being in prison, but still advancing the gospel, right? It has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. I'm in chains for Christ. Now, in the natural, on the surface, we're like, no, you're in chains for preaching about Christ. You ain't in chains for Christ. But here's what I think Paul might say. He might have said it like this. You think I'm chained down and can't preach Christ, but you've forgotten who I'm chained to. You forgot who I'm chained to. You see, it was Paul's desire his entire life to go to Rome after he became a Christian, because Rome was the center of the known world. Rome was the center of influence, and he knew if he could infiltrate Rome with the gospel would spread to the ends of the world. And so it was his desire not to go to Rome as a prisoner, but as a preacher. But he found himself in a prison, but he didn't necessarily stay in that prison mindset. He still stayed in the mindset of, I'm here to preach the good news of Jesus Christ. And I told you earlier twice that he was chained to a Roman guard, four of them that had like 6-hour shift, 24 hours a day. And these people that he was chained to, they were like part of the imperial guard. They were influencers in the Roman culture. And he is chained to them all day long. So he has what? A captive audience. So when you start to see it like this, you're like, wait a minute, who really is the prisoner in this story? Because I don't think it's Paul. I think it's the people that he's chained to, because 6 hours on their entire shift, every single day, they got to come in and hear about the good news of Jesus Christ. And don't tell me that he's not making a difference. That's how the gospel is advancing throughout the region. It's a little bit like this. And I think I've shared this story before, but we had our son Isaac several years ago in martial arts. We took him down to Terry Middleton's, and I remember being in there one day, and then just the Spirit just spoke to me so strongly when this guy did this. And it's just amazing what you can really see in this world when you finally kind of start to see with the spiritual eye. God is all around, and he's trying to speak in every single circumstance that you're in. But I was there, and we were waiting on Isaac's class to get started. And Tara Middleton's up there in front of the class he's doing prior, and there's a guy there, and he's like, hey, I want you to hit me. And this guy's like, hit you? What? I'm not going to hit you. You're going to beat the crap out of me. I ain't going to hit you. He's like, no, I need to show you and teach this class a lesson. I want you to hit me. So this guy reared back and put all his weight into a punch and went to hit him. Well, Terry Middleton, of course, did some kind of karate stuff, moved to the side, grabbed his arm, and used his own force against him and rolled him down and then just sat on him, sat on top of him in front of the class. And he was trying to teach them a lesson, right, in karate and in martial arts, that you use your opponent's force and weight against themselves. You see, whenever we get under attack from the enemy, whenever he throws his whole weight at you, whenever he throws this force at you to try to take you out, to try to rob your joy, to try to steal your witness for Christ, whenever he does this, what we need to do is just flip the script. We can flip the script and we can take what he meant for evil and we can turn it around and say, no, you might have tried to take me out, but I see that God is still doing something good through this thing. Man, we got to flip the script. We got to realize that we have the perspective to see things at a different level. Some of you right now, I already know, just even praying for people a little bit early, you're going through a test. You're going through a trial. But can I say this to you? The test that you are enduring today could be the testimony that you share tomorrow. The test that you endure today can be the testimony that you tell others about tomorrow. Speaking of testimony, let's go. Very next verse. Let's get through this thing. Paul says this, because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously. Oh, sorry, I got a different translation here. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more, oh, I like that one better, to proclaim the gospel without fear. dare all the more. People are going out and preaching about Jesus because of Paul's example. Look, man, Paul, he's being persecuted. He's awaiting trial and possible death. But that ain't stopping him. He has boldness. He has courage to preach about Jesus Christ. And if he can do that in that situation, then I think we can do it in this situation as well. Do you see the testimony that he's expressing for everyone else to follow? Does that look like your life? Are you living in such a way where when people look at your life, it instills them with more courage, where they are not afraid anymore, where they don't have fear, that they dare all the more? That's the life that God would want us to live, a life that is encouraging others. Man, God is just all over this thing. God, what do you want to do through this? It's about perspective. Let's go on. There was a little bit of division in the church. Speaking of perspective, and in verse 15, he actually says this: it is true, I guess there was something going on in the town of Philippi that Paul felt he needed to address this, but he said, it's true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. And then he says this, verse 18, but what does it matter? But what does it matter? Man, what an amazing question. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. And then he's like, okay, if you don't believe me, I'm just going to say that one more time. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. You see, apparently there were some people maybe coming through the church there in Philippi, and these people were maybe out for selfish gain. They were out just to preach and make money or maybe gather a following or, you know, just out of pride, wanted to be able to just stand up in front of people, whatever. I don't know exactly. But Paul says, look, there are some people doing that, some people out of selfish ambition, some people just out of goodwill, but both of them are preaching Christ. So he's like, what does it matter? You're getting worked up over nothing. Things that really don't matter in the grand scheme of things. Right? Some of us might need to ask the question, whatever situation we find ourselves in, right, that we wish were different, in the grand scheme of things, we need to ask ourselves, man, does this really matter? Is this going to matter 10 years from now? You know, I know one thing that I've tried to train myself to do is to look 10 years ahead and ask that question. Because if it's not going to matter in 10 years from now, why am I putting so much stress and anxiety and worry over the thing? You know, I got this saying, and Melanie gets on me all the time for saying this, and I know actually some leadership that are a part of the church here with me as well, they get kind of maybe a little upset about my kind of laid-back approach towards some things. But one of my go-to phrases with really a lot of things that I face and I see on a daily basis is this: it'll be fine. Melanie will tell you, you can have a conversation with her. This phrase drives her crazy more than anything else that I say. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. And I say that most of the time because so many people are like, no, it won't be fine. We got to take care of this right now. And they get all worked up and they get all, you know, riled up. And maybe they're nervous or anxious about something. And they're letting things bother them that don't really mean anything in the grand scheme of things. It'll be fine. It'll play out. And I know, you know, maybe I do have a little bit too much of a laid-back approach towards certain things that might matter. But at the same time, I'm beginning to train myself, is this going to matter in 10 years? Shoot, is it going to matter in a year? Is it going to matter in a month? Is it going to matter tomorrow? Because if not, I'm not going to spend time worrying about it. I'm just going to do what I know that God has called me to do, what's right in front of me right now. So what does matter? Well, God matters, right? Jesus matters. People matter. Serving those people matter. Using our gifts to make a difference in this world matters. And when we have our focus and our perspective towards those things, I'm telling you, it frees us up totally and completely. That's why Paul could go on to say one of the most stunning things or phrases in the entire Bible. And this is one of the most well-known verses, not just in the Bible, but especially in the whole book of Philippians. Probably the most quoted verse in the entire book is this. Chapter 1, verse 21. Paul says this, "For to me, to live is Christ." Basically, he's saying, look, I'm in prison and I'm awaiting trial. And if they say that I'm innocent and let me go, I'm just going to go on preaching Christ. If I stay in prison, they let me live, but I'm just going to be a prisoner the rest of my life. I'm going to preach Christ. You see, Paul is the one who wrote to the Galatians church in chapter 2, verse 20, "For I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives his life through me. This life I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave his life up for me." You see, he realized that now Jesus wanted to live his life through him. So he's like, for me to live is Christ. I'm going to go on doing what I know God's called me to do. But then he says, and to die, you know, I'm facing this trial, and if I'm found guilty and they put me to death, it's gain to me. Because then I'm going to be with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm going to be in his presence. So Paul is like, look, the perspective that I have is because I know that no matter what happens, whether I live and go on preaching or whether I get found guilty and die, either way, I win. Is that the perspective that you have whenever you're going through whatever you're facing right now? Do you have the perspective to know that you are a winner in Christ, that you are victorious in Christ, that he's called you more than an overcomer, more than a conqueror, that all the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus Christ? Because that should be the perspective that we have. We have to realize that ultimately we win. We win. Man, and when you have that perspective, all the things that tend to weigh you down just really don't matter that much. I'm going to look at one more thing, and I'm going to get Alicia to come up and help me as I close this out. We're going to just kind of read through the last few verses in this chapter, starting at verse 27. I know we've covered most of this chapter, but I hope this really speaks to you. Paul ends this first chapter by telling him this. Here it is again. Whatever happens, whatever happens, conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. Verse 29, for it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, and a lot of us don't like this, but also to suffer for him. You know, Jesus did say, in this world you will have trouble, but fear not, for I have overcome the world. And then he says this in verse 30, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and how you hear that I still have. Like, you know I'm in jail, you know I'm in prison, you know I'm facing trial and possible execution, you know I'm suffering, but I'm going to conduct myself in a manner worthy of the gospel. Matter of fact, go back to verse 27. And this is what I want to leave you with. Whatever happens, conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. As I was thinking about that this week, what's a manner worthy of the gospel? What is worthy of the gospel? You are. I am. We're worthy because he's called us worthy. Matter of fact, he thought so much of you, he went to the cross to give up his life for you, to die for you. That's how much he thought you were worthy. And so when I look at that, I'm thinking, man, no matter what happens, how am I going to conduct myself? Well, I'm going to conduct myself in a position of confidence, knowing who I am in Christ. And if I'm conducting myself in a manner where I know who I am in Christ and I walk with that confidence, realizing that I am the one worthy of the gospel because Jesus said I was worthy, that begins to change your entire mindset on whatever you go through. And so, church, I don't know who I'm speaking to here this morning, but I just have a feeling there are some of those things that happen in our life that has happened to you that you just wish were different. And you wish that somehow that, man, you just weren't in the position and the spot that you're in. But I'm telling you, there could be purpose in the pain that you're going through, because I know that God never wastes a hurt. He never wastes a hurt. He can use what you're going through to bring about glory to his name, to show himself strong. And so I'm just going to resolve within myself, no matter what I go through, I'm going to choose to have the perspective that I win in Jesus. For to live is Christ, to die is gain. Either way, I win. And if we can have that perspective, man, we can walk confidently in who we are as sons and daughters of the King. Let me pray for you real quick. Father, I just come before you, and I'm just so thankful for you. And I just pray that your Spirit just would minister to us in this place, especially those that are hurting and struggling. And God, that through your presence and the teaching of the word that we have, that we would be different. You know, right now, as just you take a moment and reflect in prayer, I know a lot of you are going through some difficult stuff, and I don't want to minimize the pain at all. I don't want to say it's no big deal, because a lot of times it is, and life can throw you some brutal punches. But in the middle of it, I just pray that you can trust God, that you can get to a place where you say, you know what? God, I'm just going to choose to listen to you through this. What do you want to say to me? What do you want to do through me? And sometimes you may look at what you're going through and say, well, it's not a big deal. I'm not going to let this weigh me down anymore. I want to be about what's most important. You know, those of you who would say, you know what? I'm in the middle of something, Pastor Shannick, and I really wish it was different. Would you just pray for me? It's something significant. I want you to know I'd be honored to pray for you. If that's you, would you just lift your hand up in this place right now? Amen. God, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would minister hope and minister faith. God, I pray that there are those today that would realize, because of your goodness, just as the enemy throws his weight toward them, God, that you can use what he meant for evil, and God, that you can turn it for their good. God, I pray that we would be encouraged, that the tests we endure could be the testimony we share tomorrow. We can tell of your faithfulness, how you worked, how you did something in us and even through us. God, I pray for your miraculous presence to give us peace that goes beyond our ability to even understand, that we would choose to trust and then surrender ourselves to do what you've called us to do, all for your glory. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray.